Wednesday morning, let's rise and shine. Separate your bed from your behind. Tell the stranger sleeping next to you to get the hell out. You've got things to do. Wednesday morning, the week's half done. Try to sober up, it's time to run. There's only 3 days left working from 9 to 5.
Hump Day is here, and it's kind of gloomy to start. Some sun later on, though. 73-ish for a high. Rode the Harley. I didn't think it was going to be.
Should be a good day. I'm excited. Should be good.
Yeah. A little chilly, though, in the area. Maybe some fog, so keep your headlights on.
Did you have double rainbows last night?
Wife let me know. I did not go upstairs to see them, but wife let me know that there were double rainbows.
It was sort of a weird rain, sun, off and on day. Went for a walk with the dogs. Beautiful out. Sunny. Had my sunglasses on. Came home, and 2 minutes later, it was raining. He's like, what the hell is happening here? And then rainbows,
Then it was light rain. Then it was heavy rain, and it was just kind of a wacky weather day yesterday. But today should be more normal with some sunshine and high temps in the low 70s. We got Shaw in the newsroom for three ways and bad news, happy music. Plus, if the phones are working, and I think they are, a chance to win $30 of my morning show money. We've had a couple of weeks with some phone issues, and hopefully they have been solved or at least patchworked enough that we can take phone calls now. So we'll check that out a bit later on. $30 of my morning show money up for grabs. Give you some ways to save money on food. Also, a third of Americans think that this counts as exercise. What is it, Gene? We'll see if you can guess correctly later. Dark Matter from Pearl Jam in just a couple minutes.
More of your Rock Mornings coming up in just a bit.
Rock Mornings, Shaw in the newsroom. Cloudy start to the day, but sun later on, mid-70s. Not bad.
Yeah, it's going to get nice, actually, over the next several days. A couple chances of rain here, but we're going to see temps reaching up to around 80 degrees by Sunday and into the 80s by Monday.
Double rainbow.
Last night?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, that was nice, huh?
Did you see it?
Did.
Nice. I did not. I stayed in the basement. Mm. Wife told me about it, though. Mm. She came down. She's like, hey, there's a double rainbow. I'm like, cool. Thanks. Not that uncommon anymore. We see that a lot more often, it seems.
I haven't seen a rainbow in a long time.
Yeah,
I
mean, other people
on Facebook and stuff like that, but with my own peepers, Shaw, it's been a while.
We had sunshine and rain at the same time, and I thought, well, there might be a rainbow out there somewhere, and sure enough.
Millions without power in Texas, speaking of severe weather.
Yeah, they got hit again.
Boy, oh boy, what a mess down there.
Storm-weary Texas has been hammered again by powerful storms, bearing forceful winds that left one person dead. Collapsed homes and uprooted trees in Dallas, where some homes were damaged. The city has opened respite centers where people can get shelter and air conditioning. The high winds were blamed for the collapse of a house that was under construction yesterday in the Houston suburb of Magnolia. A 16-year-old construction worker was killed in that collapse. The storms were a continuation of deadly storms over the Memorial Day weekend, where 24 people were killed in 7 states. La Crosse Central High School reopens today after a power outage yesterday sent students home early. Power went out building-wide, but XL Energy has now restored power, and Central will be open on schedule today. Jurors in Donald Trump's hush money trial are expected to begin their deliberations after receiving instructions from the judge on the law and the factors they may consider as they strive to reach a verdict in the first criminal case against a former American president. The deliberations will follow a marathon day of closing arguments in which the prosecutor accused Trump of trying to hoodwink voters in the 2016 presidential election by participating in a hush money scheme meant to stifle stories he feared would harm his campaign.
Are you a pothead, Farquhar?
The lawyers' dueling accounts, widely divergent in their assessments of witness credibility and the strength of evidence, offered both sides one final chance to score points with a jury.
I hear there was a little thing yesterday.
I didn't hear that. Tell me more.
Robert De Niro?
Oh, yeah. De Niro was out there bashing Trump outside the courthouse.
Like, out of left field. He just kind of shows up, and then all of a sudden it's like they're yelling and screaming at him. Somebody said, you're a nobody. It's like, I don't know if he's a nobody, bro. He's Robert De Niro. Right? You know who he is. He doesn't know who you are. And he's yelling about Trump being a bum or something like that. And
well, he's been very outspoken in his criticism of Donald Trump. And yesterday chose to speak outside of the courthouse where Trump's trial is taking
place.
Has
he been going to the trial, or he just felt like yesterday was his day to shine?
Yeah, I don't know if this was something that the Biden administration had asked him to do, if this is something he did on his own. I don't know. But clearly, he had some comments that were not favorable toward the former president.
Yeah.
And the Minnesota Timberwolves stayed alive, barely, as they earned their first victory in their Western Conference Finals series with the Dallas Mavericks. The T-Wolves were down 3-0 heading into yesterday's contest, but captured Game 4 by a score of 105-100. Game 5 to be played tomorrow night in Minneapolis.
I was wrong yesterday, by the way. I guess I didn't realize the NBA Finals are set in stone in terms of when they start, regardless
of
when the teams finish.
Yep. Because they have to prepare for the possibility of a 7-game series.
Right, and they also have to factor in what these other arenas do and, you know, in the off season or when there's playoff.
Other commitments, yeah.
Right, other commitments, concerts, and other things like that. So I guess I thought that if the Mavs would finish the series early, then they could move up the start of the NBA Finals. Because the NHL is kind of like that. The NHL is a little different. It's TBD. But in the NBA, I guess it's set in stone. Mm. So it won't begin until next Thursday, regardless of
how long this series takes to complete.
Yeah, and I was erroneous yesterday.
You were hoping your Celts were going to get a little more rest, perhaps.
And they are, thanks to, they got a full week and some change. Because they obviously finished things up on, what was it, Sunday night or Monday? Monday night. So they got almost two full weeks of rest. But the Mavs could be, or the T-Wolves could be taking a whole nother couple of days to finish their series.
So exciting. But it is.
Well, the NBA obviously doesn't want sweeps. So, they want 7 games. Yeah. They want all that ad revenue. So. Yeah. Three-way with Shaw in the newsroom. Going to play your Killing Me Shaws later on. I think the phones are working this week, Shaw.
Okay, fingers crossed.
So I think we're good. I was dicking around with them this morning after I got done. You might have heard some echoing going on as I was calling the studio line from my cell phone in the studio, and it was echoing throughout the building. But I think we're good. So $30 of my morning show money up for grabs later on. Did you watch any movies recently?
Let me think. I don't think we have really watched any. No, not in the past week. I don't think we have.
We watched that. I don't know if it's an indie flick or whatever, but like that. I told you about it last week. We watched it this weekend and I really liked it. The Last Stop in Yuma County, where the whole thing takes place at a diner, essentially.
Yep.
Almost Quentin Tarantino-ish without being like way watered down Quentin Tarantino.
Not as aggressive with the language and the violence.
But like that quirky, weird sort
more
of
more like
violent.
A Wes Anderson?
I really liked it.
All right.
I liked it.
Well, I'm not quoting that. I can tell you
that much. I'm sure of it.
We watched last night, Day After Tomorrow, which yesterday was the anniversary of its release. Dennis Quaid
movie.
Jake Gyllenhaal, Cela Ward. Yeah, disaster porn, obviously, and the weather takes over, man. Don't know if I'll quote that one. We'll see.
That's one of those movies that when it's on, I just, I'll watch this. I've seen it 100 times, probably. It's like Twister, but.
Yeah, but it's fun to watch.
It's still good.
People freezing
engaging.
To death. Yeah. And it's somewhat believable, you know what I mean? Like a lot of these sci-fi movies with the asteroids and blowing them up in space. As much as I love Armageddon, let's be honest, they're not landing. You know what I'm saying, Shaw? That's not
this. But this might.
But this one with the weather, you never know. I mean, the weather does what the weather does. You have no idea what the weather's going to do. We have no idea.
Abundant sunshine today, letting us dry out a little bit.
As you mentioned earlier, Shaw, yesterday, rain and sun, and then a double rainbow, and it's like, okay.
It's been a soggy week, really, for the most part.
Yeah. And more rain maybe Friday night into Saturday?
That looks to be our next chance, yeah.
Okay. All right. More Three Ways with Shaw, plus your Killing Me Shaws coming up after 8. Got Nirvana after Pearl Jam.
Rock Mornings. On air. Online. On the app.
Rock Mornings with Brian and Gene. That is Nirvana in Bloom. The Brewers flying the L. Losing to the Cubs in 10 innings last night. 6-1 final score. Third game of the 4-game series is tonight at 6:40. NBA last night, as Shaw mentioned earlier, the T-Wolves staved off elimination with a 105-100 win over the Mavericks. No games in the NBA tonight as that Celtics-Pacers series is over. But Game 5 between the Mavs and the T-Wolves is tomorrow night, 7:30 on TNT, that game in Minnesota. NHL last night, the Panthers beat the Rangers 3-2 in overtime. They tie that series up at 2 apiece. And tonight on the ice in the NHL, Dallas at Edmonton, 7:30. on TNT for game 4 of that series with the Stars up 2-1. As Doc said online yesterday, the worst-kept secret in racing has finally been announced. Stuart Haas Racing, 2-time NASCAR championship team with 69 Cup Series victories since its 2009 inception, will close the organization at the end of this season. Co-owners Tony Stewart and Gene Haas announcing yesterday that after this nearly a year of rumors that their 4-car Cup Series team was looking to sell its charters and either scale back or exit the stock car series completely, they have officially made it official. They're wrapping things up at the end of the season. Seattle Kraken announcing Dan Bylsma as the second head coach in the history of the team, putting him in charge of an NHL bench for the first time since 2017. Bylsma replacing coach Dave Hackstall, who was fired back in April after guiding the expansion franchise through its first 3 seasons. Kraken will be Bylsma's 3rd stop in the NHL as a head coach. He led the Pittsburgh Penguins for 6 seasons from 08 to 2014, won a Stanley Cup there in his first year on the bench. Also coached the Sabres for 2 seasons before being let go in 2017. But now he's back on the bench, this time in Seattle with the Kraken. And Lexi Thompson also hanging him up. U.S. Women's Open began for her when she was just 12 years old.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Can you imagine being able to retire from something at the age of 29? That'd be great.
Well, obviously, that's a lot.
Obviously, she's a world-class golfer. Yeah. I'm not one of those. I'm just some schlep in a building.
And she's been doing it probably as long as she can remember.
Yeah. So she's, obviously had a golf club in her hand since she was probably a toddler. But her history with the U.S. Women's Open began as a 12-year-old prodigy, when she became the youngest ever compete in the championship back in 07. She's never won the event. It seems fitting that she makes a big life announcement at the event in the lead-up to the 79th annual U.S. Women's Open at Lancaster Country Club. Lexi Thompson announced her retirement on the USGA's website. 29-year-old does plan to play out the rest of the season. Battled a hand injury for some time, has won 11 times on the LPGA, including the 2014 Chevron Championship, her only major. She also won her first LPGA title at the age of 16, setting a record that was later broken by 15-year-old Lydia Ko. So she's had a hell of a career at the age of 29, apparently battling some hand stuff, and now she's calling it a day. Might participate in some pro-ams and stuff like that.
It's, sure, it may not leave the sport behind completely, but now plays for enjoyment as opposed to the salary.
Yeah. Rock Mornings with Brian and Gene. Find us online at rockmornings.com. You can listen to the program live. You can check out our daily podcast. All of our contact info is there as well. We've got that new stuff from Five Finger Death Punch featuring DMX in just a few minutes.
Rock Mornings with Brian, Gene, and Shaw.
Guess what day it is?
Julie.
Huh?
Julie.
Huh? Guess what day it is?
Julie.
Huh?
Julie.
Huh? Guess what day it is?
Guess what day it is?
Guess what day it is? Anybody? Anybody?
Guess what day it is?
Guess what day it is? Anybody? Anybody?
Mike.
Huh?
What day is it, Mike?
Huh?
Woo-hoo!
Mike.
Huh?
What day is it, Mike?
Huh? Oh, come on. I know you can hear me.
Leslie, guess what today is? Leslie, guess what today is? Leslie, guess what today is? Leslie, guess what today is?
It's hump day.
Hump day!
Woo-hoo! It's hump day.
Hump day!
Woo-hoo!
Uh-oh.
It is, in fact, hump day, Shaw. It's here. It's a little foggy right now. It's starting to get a little...
Yeah, I'm going
to
be dealing with that here early this morning.
A little misty. But Television Tonight, season 14 premiere of MasterChef over on Fox. 1-hour Superfans Junior special, The Price is Right at Night on CBS. What is that, kids playing press?
Sounds like it. Sounds like it.
Second season finale of Maya Rudolph's sitcom Loot on Apple TV Plus today. Also Walker and Sight Unseen. Only one of the late night shows is new, and it is Kimmel. He's got Ki Hoi Kwan and Bobby Cannavale as his guests. Everybody else is in repeats. NHL action tonight on TNT, I believe. You got Dallas-Edmonton, game 4 of that series at 7:30. Brewers are on at 6:40, right, against Cubs, 3rd of 4.
Mm-hmm. This one, is it at home?
Yeah, they're in Milwaukee.
Last night, extra innings.
Yeah, extra innings last night. Almost had a no-no, right?
Close.
Yeah, seven innings, right? No hit ball.
Yep.
And NBA Finals, of course, off tonight and continue tomorrow night with the T-Wolves back in Minnesota to take on the Mavericks. Shaw in the newsroom for a three-way. What do we got?
Well, storm-weary Texas has been hammered again by more powerful storms that left one person dead, collapsed homes, and uprooted trees. In Dallas, where a number of homes were damaged, the city has opened respite centers where people can get shelter and air conditioning. The high winds were blamed for the collapse of a house that was under construction yesterday in the Houston suburb of Magnolia, where a 16-year-old construction worker was killed in the collapse. These storms were a continuation of the deadly storms that broke out over the Memorial Day weekend when 24 people were killed in seven different states. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has repeatedly accused critics of Israel or his policies of anti-Semitism, but his detractors say he's overusing that label to push his political agenda and try to quash even legitimate criticism, and that doing so risks diluting the term's meaning at a time when anti-Semitism is surging worldwide. Among other things, Netanyahu has called the U.S. college campus protests and the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court anti-Semitic. Netanyahu's supporters say he's genuinely concerned for the safety of Jews around the world. However, he's repeatedly sidestepped any accountability for not preventing Hamas's attack. A fire in Monroe County kept firefighters busy for several hours early yesterday. The fire broke out at the Barron's Gentlemen's Club near Cataract just before midnight on Monday. Crews spent 5 hours getting that blaze under control, but no one was injured. They say no one was in the bar at the time the fire broke out. They continue to look for the cause of that fire. President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris are stepping up their reelection pitch to black voters, a key part of their 2022 winning coalition that has shown signs of fraying. Launch a new black voter outreach effort during a visit to the battleground state of Pennsylvania later today. The push comes at a moment when Biden has seen his solid support among black voters show signs of erosion. Turnout for black voters could prove pivotal for Biden's chances in what are expected to be among the most closely contested states, Arizona, Georgia, Michigan, Nevada, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin. Biden beat his predecessor and 2024 challenger, Donald Trump, in all six states in 2020, but could face a more difficult climb this year.
Three-way with Shaw in the newsroom. Bad news, happy music later on. The friggin' sports. Also going to play your Killing Me Shaws just after 8 a.m. $30 of my morning show money up for grabs. No movies, though, huh?
I really haven't. I've seen bits and pieces here and there, but that's been about it.
You didn't run home yesterday and watch Street Trash after I told you all about it?
You know, you made a good pitch for it, but no, I didn't make it.
We didn't finish it. I don't know if my wife finished it without me. I went to bed, like I said. I don't know if she stayed up and watched the rest of it, but we did not finish Street Trash.
So much sporting to watch. Is that the deal?
Yeah, that's pretty much it, yeah.
Yeah.
And trying to get outside when the weather's nice.
That too, yeah. Well, and it's tough because it's been raining off and on so much, it's hard to get out there and get the lawn done. Got to do that.
Sounds like gorgeous days, though, today.
Yeah, no fog in Eau Claire this morning, but we're dealing with it in La Crosse.
Abundant sunshine and warming up quickly, 70. So yesterday and last night, I slept with the windows open last night, which obviously have been for a while. Woke up this morning, I'm like, oh, well, that was, that was chilly. It was chilly.
Mm-hmm.
We'll get to some Royal Bliss in a couple of minutes. Right now, Shinedown, it's Devil.
Rock Mornings, only on 95.7 The Rock.
Oh, man. Can't wait. Saturday night's first stop on our vacation. We added it, like, last minute. We were supposed to go to Broadfest last weekend in Madison.
And it rained?
Well, we were going to go on Friday to see Waylon because they got the original lineup back together with Mitch and Phil and Dean and Tyler. And we were excited to go, but then we were looking at the weather and we're like, eh. And then thankfully we didn't go because they ended up having to like postpone and cancel a bunch of stuff. And Waylon played at some bar in Monona. And I was like, I told the wife, I was like, that would have been a long ass drive and all that. And, you know, we were just planning on going there, seeing them and coming home. And if the weather had been perfect, it would have worked out. But, you know, all that stuff was going on. And then, of course,
festival planners. Ugh, what a nightmare.
Yeah.
What a nightmare.
Last weekend. And then, of course, Bliss was playing Broadfest as well. And we didn't get a chance to go and see them last weekend. But as we were planning our vacation and kind of going over the itinerary, I happened to see that they were playing at a place in Rockford, Illinois, a place called Murphy's Pub and Grill this Saturday. And we happen to be leaving on Saturday. So rather than driving straight through to Cleveland, We're going to actually stop and spend a night in Rockford, Illinois.
I lived there for years.
And see the boys in the band. They're playing with the Lonely Ones as well, so.
Oh, man.
It'd be cool to run into all our good friends. Yeah. I got to cook a bunch of bacon for those guys. Speaking of bacon,
yeah,
have you run into the lady at the grocery store again? Have you seen her again?
No.
Just the one time?
You're speaking about the lady who she preemptively put her stick on my conveyor belt?
She's a preemptive sticker.
She was a preemptive sticker.
So you were not done. For those who missed it maybe a couple of weeks ago, Jean was at the grocery store, was unloading her grocery cart, full grocery cart, was only about halfway done. And then the woman behind her just put the stick on the
conveyor belt,
and then started unloading her cart while Jean was still in the middle of unloading her cart.
Yes, that's exactly what happened. She sidled and then she preemptively stuck her stick in my stuff, and then I still had another half a cart left, so I had to keep pushing her stick back. And no, I have not run into her.
I know you're not a fan of confrontation, but I don't understand how you didn't say something to her.
I just kept moving her stuff back, and maybe I snorted a little
passive
bit.
Aggressive?
Like, yeah, oh, very. Okay.
Well, you obviously spent a lot of time and money at the grocery store. That should come, you know, lower a little bit. Now you got one more moving out, right?
Yeah, I'm sure over for food all the time, but that's the thing.
This is crazy, though. A poll, I saw this yesterday. A poll said that 78% of Americans now consider fast food a luxury because of how much it costs. And we've seen, you know, McDonald's talk about trying to get a $5 meal. Burger King's trying to get a $5 meal. I mean, more and more of these fast food restaurants are trying to get back to this $5 thing because 78% of Americans consider fast food a luxury item. Prices for food away from home are up almost 22% in the past 3 years. And that's across the board. Restaurants, fast food, anything you eat outside the house, prices up 22% over the past 3 years. Grocery store prices, by the way, only up 1% in the past year, but a similar 21% in the past 3 years. So it's...
I heard some statistic, and I don't know if I'm going to get it exactly right, but essentially that a family of four, feeding a family of four costs $11,000 more a year than it did 4 years ago.
That's not surprising. Here are some smart ways to save money on food when you're grocery shopping.
All right, tell me about it.
Stop being too busy to cook.
I cook all the time.
Make sure your pantry always stocked with ingredients for a quick 15-minute dinner. Then when things get hectic, that's your fallback instead of ordering something. Say, look, all right, rather than the $30 chicken bucket and pizza, you know what I mean? Yep. I'll just throw this Knorr side dish together with some frozen meat that I thawed out. Speaking of meat, number two, eat less meat. They say it's expensive. Most Americans eat too much of it anyways. You can go F yourself. I'm never eating less meat. Over time, cutting out meat once or twice a week, they say, can save you a lot of money.
I knew that. I don't do it as often as I should, but it's a good reminder.
I'll just save my grass clippings and eat those.
Well, like last night, I made enchiladas. I could have easily made those with beans and cheese and rice and skipped the chicken if I wanted. I didn't, but I could have.
Number three, stop wasting food. This definitely doesn't happen at my house. My wife may not eat leftovers, but I enjoy and thoroughly devour leftovers. Don't make enough for leftovers if you're not going to eat them. If your fresh vegetables always go bad, just switch to frozen. They'll last up to a year in the freezer. So, yeah.
I try not to have as much waste. Sometimes there's a little bit of leftovers. We eat them for lunch and all that stuff, but there's a little bit that remains. And sometimes bag salad goes bad on me before I get to it. Otherwise, I try not to.
Can I give you a tip?
What?
For bag salad?
Yes.
Do you keep it in? What do you do with it? You keep it in that bag, the bag that it comes in?
Sometimes. Sometimes I transfer it to the bowl, and I put the things on it to make it more appealing for people to just eat it right away.
Take a plastic Ziploc bag.
Yep.
Put a paper towel. Yep. Sucks all the moisture out of it. Keeps it dry. Keeps it fresher.
Sort of.
It does. It's true. In the less moisture, the less funk you're going to have. Number four on the list of five ways to save money on food. Snack less, obviously. Junk food expensive. You'll save money if you buy less of it. Also, a little side note, lose a little bit of weight. And lean on the generic brands. A lot of store brand products taste just like the name brand, so reassess which ones are actually important. So if your mayonnaise or your ketchup or your pickles or whatever, those kind of things, if you don't need to buy the name brand, tuna fish, whatever that is, you can save a few bucks buying the generic stuff. But I'm surprised you haven't run into her. She must not be a regular at your grocery store of choice.
Well, I went to a different grocery store this weekend just because we were at another side of town and had the dog at the groomer or whatever. So we spent money at the other place this week.
All right. We'll get to some Tool in a couple of minutes. If you need something, get in touch with us. Visit rockmornings.com.
Rock Mornings, Monday to Friday, 6 to 9.
The Mighty Tool with Sober. Rock Mornings, Brian, Gene, and Shaw. We'll talk to him in just a couple of minutes. Did you get a nice gift after you graduated high school or college?
I got a ring because I didn't get a class ring.
Okay.
Because my parents were like, do you really want that? So I got a ring in place of my class ring for graduation, and I got a typewriter.
My parents took me to Denny's and gave me a Mickey Mouse watch when I graduated junior high school.
Oh, that's cool.
I guess. Denny's. I look back at it now and I'm like, thanks.
That was sweet.
Not really. I mean, whatever. High school senior in Boston recently won a $10,000 scholarship, beating out five other finalists, but an anonymous donor behind the scholarship, the $10,000 scholarship, decided that everybody else deserved to win the $10,000 too.
That $50,000 means that all six of our finalists will receive the $10,000
scholarship. I'm so excited. Thank you so much. It means a lot. This is going to make going to college a lot easier.
My dream is to one day become a judge. So, you know, go to law school, be a lawyer for a little bit. And then I would like to be on the Supreme Court. I could use this money to either give back to my community or pay for my college tuition. That'll make me feel so happy.
You need a little more than that 10 grand if you want to become a Supreme Court judge. Just saying. Six senior students from six different Boston high schools recognized for their academic achievements. All of them nominees for a $10,000 scholarship from the publisher Scholastic, right? The, what is that?
Yeah.
Books and news articles and all that stuff. Julie Cyprian of East Boston High School was ultimately the winner.
So she was supposed to get the $10,000 solely, quote
right.
unquote. And then
but there was an anonymous benefactor who was so impressed with everybody else's work that they donated an additional 50 grand. The person who donated the first 10 grand donated an additional 50 grand.
Because the other applicants had such an impressive resume.
So each of the six finalists got 10 grand to go to college. How cool is that?
That's great.
You know what else is great? Veterans. Obviously, over the weekend, Memorial Day, took some time, hopefully, to pause and reflect and remember and think about all of the veterans who paid the ultimate price to protect our freedoms here in this wonderful country that we get to live in.
I spoke to a vet yesterday who spent his early morning on Monday out putting 654 flags in the cemeteries.
A lot of that, a lot of parades, a lot of memorials.
Mm-hmm.
Here's a guy who's still living, an Army vet in central Pennsylvania, who just keeps on kicking ass and taking names. Saved the lives of two fishermen on Memorial Day when their boat sank in a remote section of a river. He's just out there doing some fishing, hanging out, and these guys, I'm going down, Captain, down, going down, help! And this guy was in the right place at the right time.
I would thought we were pretty much done because that current is pretty wicked, and I didn't think anybody was around at first until I saw those people on that pontoon. Thank God for them, I'll tell you what.
We were actually on the phone with the marina about to head back in just due to the weather, and one of my friends, Allie, pointed out that there was a boat calling for help right next to us.
Always wear your life jacket. No matter how good of a swimmer you are, that sucked. That current was wicked.
Our family was based on service, and I'm just glad I was there to help them, and it feels good to know that I possibly saved their life that day.
The guy's name is Mark Latanzi. He spent 8.5 years in the Army. He's now a fitness instructor. He was on a party boat with his friends. These guys are going down. Everything on the boat was lost, but the two guys are okay. Was able to scoop them up out of the river, just having a nice little Memorial Day putt-putt around the lake. Heard these guys calling for help, went and saved their lives.
Always wear your life jacket. That's good advice.
Joel Esch and Jason Hoover, their boat began to take on water, and within minutes it was sinking. As you heard there, he said, thought we were done for. However, this guy, Army veteran, Mark Latanzi, was able to get over there with his pontoon and his friends and get these guys out of the water. Fishing poles, tackle boxes, boat all destroyed, but the two men able to walk away. And that's, I guess, really what matters, right?
That's all that matters. That's all that matters.
Pretty cool. Hell of a save. We got, let's see, Linkin Park in a few minutes, and Scott Robert Shaw coming up in just a bit.
Rock Mornings with Brian, Gene, and Shaw.
Rock Mornings with Brian, Gene, and Shaw in the newsroom. A third of Americans think that this counts as exercise. What is it, Shaw?
Playing pool.
Gene?
Deep breathing.
Shaw?
A walk around the block.
Gene?
A third? Is that what you said?
Third. 33% of Americans think that this counts as exercise.
I want to be creative here. Pumping your own gas. Is that a thing? I'm trying to think of what... chores, but that is exercise. Like vacuuming or washing dishes, those are considered,
you're getting
though,
there.
Right?
You're getting there.
Mm-hmm. Well, getting up off the couch.
Said, thank you and helped me with the dishes.
Fine. I'll help you do the dishes.
Oh, come on. You know what? No, that's not what I want.
You just said that you want me to help you do the dishes.
I want you to want to do the dishes.
Why would I want to do dishes?
Doing dishes, doing chores?
Has there ever been a more clear answer than that?
Why would I want
to do dishes? Not a large amount of Americans answering this poll, only about 2,000 people. But in this new poll of 2,000 Americans, a third of us think that everyday chores like doing the dishes counts as exercise.
I think so. Oh, well, maybe not just.
You're moving.
And laundry?
If you're doing all of the chores, yes. If you're just doing the dishes, no.
Right, I would say
that. Saturday, where you're vacuuming, you're dusting, your laundry, all that stuff.
You're changing the sheets on the bed, you're going downstairs, wash and dry, and put them back on. That's
98% of people say you don't need to go to a gym to get a good workout. 54% of us never see the inside of a gym, but the average person still claims to exercise 4 times a week thanks to things like dishes and whatnot.
Mopping a floor, Shaw?
Cutting the grass, you're walking. And
oh, Jesus Christ, don't even get me started. I'm dying out there. I got to go inside. It's like, oh, my God. People are asked to name the top everyday tasks that count as exercise. Here are the top 10. Number one, walking around your neighborhood.
Walking, sure.
They say the walking is one of the best exercises. Low impact. It's good for your heart. Sure. It's anybody can do it.
I went on 2 walks yesterday and saw, by the way, it's a season, 4 turtles doing their turtle thing.
Don't be the guy that runs them over. I'm not saying you got to stop and move every turtle, but go around them or be careful.
Really slow. You should be able to see them.
74% of people say that all the walking you do in a day counts as exercise.
I would say, yeah.
And it's 8,000 steps now, right? It's not 10,000?
Oh, is that right?
Didn't we find out it's 8 instead of 10?
Well, 8's better than none.
I still shoot for that.
Taking the stairs instead of an elevator, 60% of people say that, yes, that counts as exercise, obviously. Doing yard work.
There you go, Shaw.
Yep.
Oh, man. You get an 82-degree day and...
You're
a lot of humidity, and I'm dying out there. Dying.
Picking weeds.
Cleaning. Just general cleaning the house. 59% of people say that counts. Taking your dog for a walk. Bringing groceries in from the car. Gardening. Taking out the trash. I don't know. Maybe like collecting all the trash from around the house, all the walking around different barrels and bringing it out. And I don't know. Maybe. Stretching after getting out of bed counts as exercise, apparently, according to this poll.
Either of you do that?
I stretch, not right away, necessarily.
I think they are inferring, like, my grandfather used to do because he had a bad back. So he would have to get up and do, like, calisthenics as opposed to stretching.
I mean, do you really do the whole stretching?
Some people have to. They got to, you know, they can't move.
No, I know.
My 86-year-old mother exercises before she even gets out of bed. She does a thing where she lays on her back and puts her feet in the air and does, like, a bicycle motion just as a way to get things moving before she ever puts her foot on the floor.
And last but not least here, as we mentioned, a third of Americans count doing the dishes or a load of laundry as exercise. All by itself, it sounds like, not just as part of the other chores.
I don't know if I'd call doing dishes chore, but I definitely I have to go up and down the stairs with laundry.
Several times.
Yes.
But yeah, a third of Americans shall count doing the dishes as exercise.
Dishes are done, man.
Especially if you're just throwing them off the roof and shooting at them like a skeet shooting competition, Shaw.
Makes it pretty easy to get the chores done.
Hell yeah. Makes it real easy. Yeah, I tell you, dude, mowing my lawn, the way that I mow it, the way that I'm meticulous and all that stuff, it's.
Did you ever do the crisscross pattern yet?
I'm working on it.
Okay.
I've had too many inputs when it comes to...
Too much advice?
Yeah, you know, you talk about this crap on the radio, and every Tom, Dick, and Harry has got some sort of, like, solution to your problem. Not that I need a solution. I can figure it out on my own. But, yeah, everybody and their grandmother is coming out telling me what I need to do, this, that, the other thing.
Just mow it in a pattern. See what happens.
Well, I've got the lines, and I you know, you want to mow in different directions to keep the grass growing properly and all that stuff, and I'm going to be gone over the next 2 weeks, Sean. So the people that that take care of my lawn, my lawn service guy, he's going to mow for me for a couple weeks, and he's been sending me messages on Facebook telling me that I may hire him full time.
Oh, you might be so impressed when you get back.
He said he's going to send me pictures while I'm on vacation.
Nice. You're going to be salivating at those because
yeah, I'm going to be salivating because the bill is going to be really friggin' high. I have standards, Shaw. I gotta keep up with the Joneses.
You're a lawn guy.
Well, I told you the other day, Monday? Yeah, Monday. We went over and hung out with the neighbors for a little bit before, you know, the end of the day, and got another compliment from the neighbor across the way, Tom.
Tom yelled out, nice lawn. Lawn.
He's like, damn, your lawn's looking good. I'm like, I know. Not one of these hippies with their stupid.
I'm gonna have to mow in the next couple May. Days.
By the way, that's coming to an end.
Thank God. God, we got like two houses in our. I can see why people do the HOA thing. That might be a thing for you know me. I'm not HOA like the whole thing with the HOAs and all the rules and stuff. But having somebody not be able to do that to their lawn, it's disgusting to walk by and see that. It looks like someone doesn't live there.
Well, they'll have a lot of work to do this week when that comes to an end.
You got to get a brush hog out there. You can't do that even with a weed whacker. You got to get out there with a, you know, chainsaw.
Industrial equipment.
Hell yeah. Yeah, it's definitely mow day today or tomorrow, Shaw.
Mm-hmm. Things dry
high temps in the 70s and some sunshine. We'll get more information and news from Shaw next time we talk to him. Also got some Linkin Park in a few minutes. Right now, it's Billy Morrison and Ozzy Osbourne, Crack Cocaine.
Rock Mornings on 95.7 The Rock.
Linkin Park with Faints on Rock Mornings with Brian and Gene. You got the Brewers losing to the Cubs in 10 innings last night. Third game of the four-game series tonight at 6:40. T-Wolves able to stave off elimination last night against the Mavericks with a 105-100 win. They bring that series back to Minnesota.
Maybe some home cooking, huh?
Maybe.
Get this going maybe yeah. A little bit.
Game 5 will be tomorrow night at 7:30 on TNT between the Mavs and the T-Wolves. NHL last night, Panthers over the Rangers 3-2. That game in overtime. Panthers able to tie the series up at 2 apiece. Over in the NHL tonight, Dallas at Edmonton 7:30 on TNT for game 4 of that series. The Stars are up 2-1. As we mentioned earlier, Stuart Haas Racing, 2-time NASCAR championship team with 69 Cup Series victories since they got started back in 2009, will close its organization at the end of the season. Doc texted in, said 3 of the 4 Stuart Haas charters have already been spoken for. They'll have more details on Friday. It sounds like those drivers are going to go
somewhere else.
Somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Taking their talents to South Beach, right? Colorado football safety Shiloh Sanders, Deion's kid.
Yeah.
Coach Prime has been facing questions in court about his personal income and wealth after filing for bankruptcy last October with more than $11 million in debt. The debt stems primarily from what a court in Texas says he owes to a security guard at his former school, a man who claims Sanders assaulted him back in 2015 and gave him severe and permanent injuries, including neurological injuries and damage to his cervical spine.
This is the kid?
So this is Deion's kid.
Somebody's saying that this happened.
So at his former school, a former security guard there apparently sued him and won a $12 million judgment for damages from the incident. The guy's name is John Dargene. He sued Sanders for damages from the incident, won a $12 million judgment against him after Sanders failed to show up for the trial in 2022. I'm not going to go to court.
Yeah.
Let's not go. What's the worst that could happen? Well, you don't win. Sanders, who, of course, is the son of Colorado head coach Deion Sanders, filed then for bankruptcy as a result in an effort to discharge his debt, but Jardine is still trying to collect his judgment against Sanders, has now raised questions in court about Shiloh Sanders' earnings from the NIL deals in college. Because that kid's got a bunch. He's making plenty of money.
And he has this money coming to him. That's a true story, isn't
but
it?
But you can file bankruptcy to protect yourself from those things and see what happens. Well, that's nice.
Yeah, that's nice.
Rock Mornings with Brian and Gene. We will talk to Scott Robert Shaw again in just a bit. Plus, after 8, phone's working. Fingers crossed.
Yep.
We'll give someone a chance to score $30 of my morning show money with your Killin' Me Shaws.
Rock Mornings with Brian, Gene, and Shaw.
Rock Mornings with Brian and Gene. That is Sleep Theory, Numb. David Buckner, former drummer for Papa Roach, 47 today. Mel B of the Spice Girls, 49. Spice Girls.
What's her birthday? How old is she?
49. Mel B. She was Scary Spice. She'll tell you what she wants, what she really, really wants. Noel Gallagher, one half of Oasis, 57. Because, baby, you're gonna be the one that saves me. Okay, that's enough of that. That'll get in your head, huh?
Yeah.
57. Those two boys.
They don't get along too well.
But, never say never, right?
We'll see.
I don't think I don't think those two are ever going to figure it out. Blaze Bailey, who was the singer for Iron Maiden when Bruce Dickinson left in the mid-90s, is 61 years young. Also turning 61 today, Lisa Welchel. Played Blair
61.
On The Facts of Life.
Take the good, you take the bad.
You take them both, Shaw. The Facts of Life. The Facts of Life. There's a time you got to grow and show.
Mm-hmm.
No?
Yeah, I think that's how it goes.
Okay. Lisa Welchel, 61, played Blair. Wasn't she the rich blonde one? That was her?
Yes.
Melissa Etheridge is 63. Didn't her and her wife have a baby from David Crosby? Is that them?
Correct.
He was not
the
that,
surrogate.
Not that he like showed up and, I mean, I think it was all official, like lab tested and
medical
all that
stuff. Yeah,
right. Not like, hey, come over for a wild weekend and
let's take a hayride and see what happens.
A hayride. That's a good one. Danny Elfman is 71. He was in Oingo Boingo way back in the '80s, but now he has become a movie composing genius. He has composed and scored Beetlejuice, Batman, Sleepy Hollow, Mission Impossible, Men in Black, Spy Kids, Spider-Man, Alice in Wonderland, Dark Shadows, and on and on. Danny Elfman Shaw, 71 today. Born on this day in 1917, killed in 1963, our 35th president.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
JFK. John F. Kennedy, born on this day in 1917. Assassinated on November 22nd of 1963. Also born on this day in 03. That's 1903. Bob Hope died in 03. That's 2003. That guy, Bob Hope.
100 years old, huh?
71 years ago today. Interesting that you brought this up yesterday, Shaw. I actually saw the photo. The Mount Everest logjam. I looked at it and I was like, oh, Shaw's right. There is a traffic jam.
Mm-hmm.
Well, 71 years ago today in 1953, Sir Edmund Hillary of New Zealand, along with his Sherpa,
he was the first,
became the first climbers to reach the top of Mount Everest. When asked what his first thought was when he reached the summit, he said, quote, how to get down.
That video is crazy, isn't it? Of all the people at the top of the mountain.
Well, and I think, again, it's about favorable conditions and there's only so many people that can go and... So you all got to do it at the same time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Nuts.
32 years ago today, 1992, Whoopi Goldberg and Sister Act in theaters. No?
My wife likes that movie.
The first one or the second one or both of them?
I don't know. First one, I guess.
First one, okay. There was a second one. 2009, the movie Drag Me to Hell in theaters right across the hall in 2009.
He is a good and smart master, and he made me this collar so that I may talk. Squirrel! My master is good and smart.
It's not possible.
Oh, it is, because my master is smart.
Pixar's Up in theaters on this day in 2009. You know they got Airbnbs that you can stay at? that looked just like the house.
I think I did hear about that, yeah.
That's fun.
Yeah. Not the only, I mean, there's...
It's like a treehouse. You got to climb up into it.
I don't know if it's a treehouse, but it's the yellow with the balloon sticking out of it and all that stuff. But yeah, they've got...
That's fun.
14 years ago today, 2010, Easy Rider director Dennis Hopper lost his battle with prostate cancer at the age of 74.
Pop quiz, hot shot. There's a bomb on a bus.
Yeah. But I'm taller.
I'm taller than you.
I didn't know he directed Easy Rider.
Yeah, he did.
I had no idea. I didn't know that.
Isn't that one of your favorites, Joe?
It's up there. It's a good movie.
And in 2015, 9 years ago today, Betsy Palmer died at the age of 88. She, of course, had a long acting career, but most notably in the very first Friday the 13th film as Jason Voorhees' mom.
Well, I'm Mrs. Voorhees, an old friend of the Christies.
Steve should never have opened this place again. There's been too much trouble here. Did you know that a young boy drowned the year before those two others were killed? The counselors weren't paying any attention. They were making love while that young boy drowned. His name was Jason.
He was my son.
You see, Jason was my son. And today is his birthday.
Ooh. Got her head chopped off for all that trouble, though.
Oh, thank you.
And there you go. Some birthdays and stuff that happened. Shaw in the newsroom for stuff that's happening right now. What's the news?
Well, a former Winona State University football player allegedly hit and killed a 93-year-old priest while driving, but apparently while looking at his phone instead of the road. Clay Schuffner has been charged with homicide by negligent operation of a vehicle in Milwaukee County. The 24-year-old former Winona State linebacker was possibly looking at Snapchat or GPS on one of his two phones when he hit the priest with his truck in Wauwatosa. The priest, David Gao, died shortly after being hit. Police said Schuffner got out and walked toward Gao after hitting him. He told police he was looking at his speed and GPS before hitting the man and did not have time to react. GPS and other apps were being used on one of his two phones. Schuffner did not tell police he was using Snapchat at the time of the crash. One Wisconsin senator will be talking about drug-related issues during two stops in the state today. Senator Tammy Baldwin travels to Green Bay and Wausau. At the Green Bay event, Democrat Baldwin is expected to meet with police to talk about the dangers of the drug fentanyl. Then, in Wausau, Baldwin will have a roundtable discussion about the price of buying inhalers. She wants big drug companies to reduce the cost of inhalers. A trio of events tomorrow to focus awareness on equitable transportation and street safety in the city of La Crosse, with multiple ways for the community to get involved. One of those is a bicycle ride with Mayor Mitch Reynolds around the city with frequent stops at key points to hear from guest speakers on new development and future plans. Another focuses on panel discussions and presentations over local projects. The last is a viewing at the Rivoli Theater, the documentary The Street Project, about the global citizen-led fight to make streets safer. The film will be followed by an open Q&A with multiple panelists. A battle of the first pick in the WNBA draft versus the second pick went to the latter, at least in the win column. But Caitlin Clark scored a season-best 30 points to go along with 6 assists, 5 rebounds, 3 steals, and 3 blocks as her Indiana Fever fell to the LA Sparks 88-82. Clark was the number one pick in last month's draft, while Cameron Brink went number 2 to LA. Brink finished last night with just 3 points, 3 rebounds, and 2 assists. Clark now averaging just over 17 points on about 38% shooting, but the Fever fell to 1-7 on the season.
Rough start.
It is. Been watching them. They're kind of hard to watch sometimes. Sloppy.
She's figuring it out, though, right?
Yeah. I mean, last night was her best game as a pro.
Wow. 8 games. You're getting a little time out here, you know?
Yes, exactly. She's likely to have a long career. Let's not judge her on a handful of games.
Man, did you see that foul that Angel Reese took the other night?
No, I did not.
Good Lord. Mm-mm. That was a welcome to the WNBA moment. She went up and she got clotheslined.
Oh, man.
Legit, the girl just, wah, wah! She went down hard.
Oof.
Yeah. I think there's some girls that are playing in the WNBA who don't like these young girls getting all the shine. And, of course, we heard from Charles Barkley last week talking about, you know, giving Caitlin her flowers and all that stuff. And there's been, I know Jamel Hill has said that Caitlin Clark's only getting all the love because she's straight and she's white and she's pretty. And, I mean, it's just, I feel so bad. It's right. Like you're just trying to go out there and play basketball, and you got to have the weight of the world on your shoulders when it comes to women's sports right now. And, like, it's like everybody and their grandmother's got an opinion about you. And, yeah, I'm
she's handled it well, though. I mean, despite being under the microscope.
Yeah, I think they both have. I think all of them, you know, whoever it is, whether it's Angel Reese or Caitlin Clark or Camila Cardoza, any of them. But I can't imagine the pressure that they're under, you know? And then you got to go out there and try to be, like, as good as you were in college. And it's like, there's going to be some growing pains, bro. Mm-hmm. Take some time. You ready to play?
Sure, why not?
All right, we're not doing any practice rounds today, but I think
this is the real deal.
I think the phones are working. I think. So we'll see. I was testing them out this morning, Shaw, so I think we'll be able to get an actual caller to call in and hopefully play your Killing Me Shaws. We'll do that just after 8 o'clock this morning. $30 of my morning show money up for grabs. If we can't figure out the phones, then
we'll figure it out.
We'll just keep adding 10 bucks until the engineers fully explain how these things work around here. But, yeah, your Killing Me Shaws is coming up in just a bit. Right now, it's a band that's going to be here in August. Saturday, August 3rd at Copeland Park and Event Center. Bush, along with Jerry Cantrell from Alice in Chains, Candlebox, and Tim Montana. It's Glycerine.
Rock Mornings on your rock station.
Rock Mornings with Brian and Gene, Bush, and Glycerine. Saturday, August 3rd, Copeland Park and Event Center. Just had Seether, Skillet, Fuel, 10 Years, and Keith Wallen of Breaking Benjamin back in May.
This is a nice retro show on it that is. Saturday to kick off August, though, that Saturday night, August 3rd.
It's actually still May. But yeah, just a couple weeks ago, feels like forever ago already, that we kicked off the summer concert series over there at Copeland Park and Event Center with that Seether and Skillet show, and now we've got our next one on August 3rd. Tickets available at CopelandEvents.com. And then we'll have a part three that we should be announcing here at some point in the near future.
What's nice about that show, August 3rd, is it's still summer and it's before you're starting to get super, super busy with the kids going back to school and all of that. And, but you're over the holidays of the 4th of July and the craziness of all of that stuff.
And it's a
Rock
Saturday.
Fest and everything. So it's a Saturday night and it's the beginning of August and it's a fun, that'll be a fun night. Good music.
Speaking of Candlebox, who are coming with Bush and Jerry Cantrell, we'll hear from them next. And we'll see if we can get a winner, or a caller at least, to play your Killing Me Shaws in just a bit.
More of your rock mornings coming up in just a bit. One of them can have an entire conversation made up of movie quotes.
I paid the fool.
The other two usually have no clue what the he just said.
You like movies about gladiators?
We love to party.
I'll be back.
Wednesday mornings at 8:15. Win Brian's morning show money.
They're always after me, Lucky Charms.
By playing You're Killing Me Shaws.
You're killing me, Smalls.
I want you to be nice. Until it's time to not be nice.
$30 of my morning show money up for grabs with your Killing Me Shaws. And as far as I know, the phones work. I tried them this morning. Several different options, several different buttons.
I think we're good. I think we're golden. This is golden.
I see somebody calling right now.
Ooh, let's do this.
We'll see if we can get a winner here.
This.
Or at least a caller. Gene, what do you think? Is he going to know the movie quote or is he not going to know the movie quote?
I think he will.
You're going with yes, and why are you saying yes?
You're
he hasn't watched
on
any
vacation,
movies.
And you're going out on a high note. You want to make people winners. You want to make Shaw feel good about his knowledge and the things that he understands and knows about movies. And so you're gonna.
All right, Gene thinks that he's gonna get it.
I do.
Her opinion is irrelevant. It's all about caller 15 on the Rock Line 608-784-0957. Give us a call if you want to play your Killing Me Shaws and try to win $30 of my morning show money. Again, if your phone doesn't suck ass, I can hear you clearly. If you don't have the radio up really loud, you don't have a bunch of kids in the background screaming blue bloody murder.
Honestly, if you just can call in and get through, we're going to be just happy about it.
We're going to take caller 15.
Just going to take the call.
And see if we can get a winner. We'll see if we can get a winner here. But caller 15 on the Rock Line gets to play your Killing Me Shaws and maybe, possibly, potentially, perhaps win $30 of my morning show money.
Rock Mornings. On air. Online. On the app. One of them can have an entire conversation made up of movie quotes.
I paid the fool.
The other two usually have no clue what the he just said.
You like movies about gladiators?
We love to party.
I'll be back.
Wednesday mornings at 8:15. Win Brian's morning show money.
They're always after me, Lucky Charms.
By playing You're Killing Me Shaws.
You're killing me, Smalls.
I want you to be nice.
Until it's time to not be nice.
$30 of my morning show money up for grabs. trying to get this phone thing figured out.
How's that working?
I just want to die. I just don't want to be here anymore. Everything sucks. Nothing works, and I'm sick of it.
We got it, Sean. We're figuring it out. It's technology. We got it. We're good. We got it.
Everything was fine until we upgraded. Nothing works when you upgrade. It never works. Everything was fine.
You got to get everything.
The old stuff works.
Just sinking.
Jean thinks you're going to know it. She, for some reason, is positive today. Maybe because I'm so effing negative all the time, Shaw.
Got to balance you out.
I'm never coming back from my vacation.
See, I think he's going to make you a winner before he leaves. He's going on vacation, and he wants you to be a winner, Shaw, before. So I think that you're going to know it.
You know what I don't want to do right before I go on vacation is give someone else my money. Some stranger on the phone. Right, Shaw?
I'm guessing that's the case.
Jean thinks you're going to get it. Her opinion is irrelevant. It's all about caller 15. Hang with us here. The audio. I'm trying, bro.
I know.
I'm trying.
I know.
How can I make your job less stressful? I don't know. Make sure the stuff I need works. Maybe. Maybe that works.
We got it, Shaw.
Dave, do you know how to play this game?
I do.
Dave, do you think Shaw's going to know the movie quote or not?
I do. I believe he's going to know it.
What are you going to do with $30 of my morning show money if you win, Dave?
Oh, I don't know. Buzzard Billy's, maybe.
All right, so
going
Dave,
out to eat.
There you go.
Dave thinks you're going to know it, Shaw, and he's going to go to Buzzard Billy's in case you missed all that.
I caught it.
Okay.
Ring, ring.
Yeah.
We'll get there.
I know.
This is fun. This is what I like to do right before I go on vacation. I don't even care. I don't even, whatever. Just
guess something, would you?
Here's the movie quote, Shaw. Here you go.
Gobble, gobble, mother.
Oh, jeez.
I've heard that before.
Yeah, I have too.
You want to hear it again?
Yeah.
All right, here we go.
Gobble, gobble, motherfucker.
Okay, yike. It's got to be a scary movie, doesn't it?
By the way, we're not doing this when I'm on vacation, because if I can't handle it, you know who can't handle it?
I'm not.
Gene can't handle it. So if you get it right, Shaw, then Dave wins $30 of my morning show money. If you don't get it right, then we'll add $10, but we won't play again until I get back from vacation.
That's got to be a scary movie.
Which might never happen.
Yeah, I know you've played this movie clip before.
Yeah.
I don't remember.
Gobble, gobble, mother.
Probably some obscure
scary
movie. That
what
I've
does
never
he say
of
there, Shaw?
Gobble, gobble, mother. Mm-hmm.
Mm.
Yeah, I caught that. I don't know where it came from.
Some sort of axe murderer.
Right? And I don't watch those types of movies, generally speaking.
You're really missing out, Shaw.
Am I? I don't know. Is that from Ghostbusters?
No. Nope. The movie is...
What fine movie was that?
The movie is another Oscar award-winning film that I have sat through several times.
Oh, man.
It's one of the better Thanksgiving films. It's called Thanksgiving.
of course it is.
Where the turkey goes on a killing spree.
Oh.
The turkey goes...
Yeah, it actually like launches its head and beak and everything through other people.
A bird.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like an actual bird.
That is a big bird.
And at one point...
Not somebody dressed
as a
bird.
At one point, he says, gobble, gobble, mother bleeper.
The bird does.
Yeah. Thanks, Killing Shaw.
Mm-hmm. Classic.
Oh, yeah. It's coming
honestly,
through.
I just... whatever.
That was the first one you came upon, so you played that one.
It was on the same screen.
Oh!
Yeah, I told you. I'm dealing with glue and Band-Aids here, Shaw. I'm trying my best.
I know.
Sorry.
Almost made it.
Sorry, Dave. You did not win. That means it'll be $40 of my morning show money if and when I return from vacation.
Shaw, that movie is not for you.
Probably
I just
not.
Saw a clip, just the gobble gobble clip, and it is the turkey's head comes out
the other side of the body.
Other side of the guy.
I told
he's
you.
He's got cut off sleeves and a can, and then all of a sudden he's impaled, and then the bird comes out through his chest and says that the
there
turkey
is
does.
There is some gratuitous nudity in the film, which helps.
That is not for you, Shaw. That is...
Yeah, I wasn't going to put it on my list.
$40 of my morning show money up for grabs the next time we play this game.
What is happening?
A few weeks from now.
Maybe. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm at the end of the rope here, man. I'm dealing.
Somebody needs a vacation.
Yeah. It's been 6 months, bro. 8 months, actually. When did I go on vacation? October? Yeah, it's been a long time. I'm sorry. Thanksgiving. I think the second... If don't quote me on
there
this.
There's a sequel?
Oh, yes.
Oh, no!
So, it became a cult film, obviously, where, you know, you come up with a weird premise and lots of blood and lots of boobs and people enjoy it. And I'm pretty sure, and don't quote me on this, you can Google it. The premise for the second movie, the sequel, is that the turkey... The turkey from the first one steals the film, like a truck full of the DVDs of the second movie, and that is now the third movie. Okay. It's some sort of weird meta thing. I don't know if I've ever seen either or any of the sequels, but I think if I'm incorrect, then correct me, please feel free. But I'm pretty sure that the second one is actually the third one, because the second one gets the premise of the third one is that the second one got stolen by the turkey from the first one. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
As much sense as that movie makes.
They're all called Thanksgiving.
Okay. Yeah, I think so. I don't know. Bad news, happy music. Please tell me we got something I can laugh at.
Oh, well, let's see. A daycare worker is in hot water after a child was allegedly exposed to cocaine at a daycare in southeastern Wisconsin. The child's parents took their kid to the hospital after noticing several scratches and marks on the child's body. An investigation later confirmed the child had consumed cocaine. Detectives searched the daycare and found drugs in an employee's backpack. That staff member was arrested. Child neglect, possession of a controlled substance, and other felony charges are being referred to the Milwaukee County District Attorney's Office. The city of Eau Claire has cleaned up raw sewage from a bike path along Blazing Star Boulevard. That sewage came from a backup at the Eau Claire River lift station. 500 gallons of sewage seeped into the trail on Monday. Crews spent the day yesterday power washing the area. The pipe that backed up has now been replaced. The Godfather producer, Albert Ruddy, has died at the age of 94. The Canadian-born producer and writer won Oscars for The Godfather and Million Dollar Baby and developed the prison sports comedy The Longest Yard and helped create the hit sitcom Hogan's Heroes. He died over the weekend. He produced more than 30 movies, and some of them great, some of them not so much. The Godfather and Million Dollar Baby were box office hits and winners of Best Picture Oscars, but Ruddy also helped give us Cannonball Run 2 and Megaforce, nominees for Golden Raspberry Awards for the worst movie of the year.
What's wrong with Cannonball 2?
That they made it?
It's not as good as the first one? Is that what you're trying to tell me?
Yeah, had some real stars in it. Burt Reynolds. And...
Give it to me. Am I right?
Thanksgiving. Well, by the way, on Rotten Tomatoes, Shaw, it's doesn't have great reviews. I just want to tell you that the very first one is far from a good film. It says... ranking foul on almost every aspect of
foul,
filming.
Get it, Shaw? Foul like
foul,
a bird.
Foul, did you get that? So, I'm not really sure if I can follow what's going on exactly, but...
Again, I think it's kind of meta.
It's not funny, though, it says. Is it not funny? It
depends on your sense of humor. Look, critics are paid to be critical. I can... watch it and tell you it's not great, but I can enjoy it at the same time.
Thanksgiving 3 came out in 2012.
And the premise is that the second movie got stolen by the bird, and that's now the third movie, right?
I don't know. I think that's what happened. Terrible.
Well, you're welcome.
This is terrible.
You're welcome. Go down that rabbit hole. Go down it. We got the friggin' sports coming up after Finger 11. Bad news, happy music on the way as well.
Rock Mornings with Brian, Gene, and Shaw.
Summer.
Rock Mornings with Brian and Gene. Finger 11, Paralyzer. Olympics right around the corner.
Mm-hmm.
Snoop Dogg.
Going to be doing some commentating.
Athletes able to have sex again.
Mm-hmm.
Got all them condoms.
Distribution of the free condoms.
Hell yeah. Going to be some banging going on. And the French citizens apparently are very unhappy.
With what?
About the money being spent on the Olympics. So upset, in fact, that they are going to have a sit-in, but with an H. A sugar honey iced tea in. So some of the athletes, the swimmers, gonna be in the big French, what is it, the Seine? I think is how they pronounce it. The big river there.
They want them to poop in the river?
They're mad at the government for spending all that money on stuff when they have other needs in their country. And so a bunch of people are trying to get together and poop in the river. I love this.
To make it unhospitable for the
swimmers?
It
already is, from what I've heard. I've already heard it's pretty nasty. But French citizens are planning a controversial protest against the government's expensive plan to clean up the Seine River in Paris for the 2024 Olympic Games. The protest involves a mass defecation flash mob.
Poop again!
He caught the shit poop!
Oh, right.
Again, a mass defecation flash mob in the river on the day President Emmanuel Macron and Paris Mayor Anne Hidalgo are scheduled to take a swim there to promote the river's cleanliness. Let's wait till the governor or the president and the mayor are in the water and we're all just pooping it.
Yeah.
So it's okay. It's just Baby Ruth's candy bar.
Yeah, it's fine. It'll be fine.
According to the news report, the unusual form of protest reflects a long-standing tradition of radical demonstrations in France. The hashtag... Okay.
Is this where you can't swear?
Well, it's French, so stick with me here. I can't even... I have no idea. There's a hashtag that says, I poop in the Seine on June 23rd.
Oh, geez.
Je chais dans la Seine le 23rd juin. I poop in the Seine on June 23rd began trending on social media after Mayor Hidalgo announced the planned swim. A website with the very same name allows participants to register locations for the protest. So that way the government knows where you are when you're pooping in the river.
If you don't come over here and lick that white dog shit, I'm going to plow into your nose with my fist.
I am not licking any white dog.
I'll lick the dog shit if you leave us alone.
Dale, you're not licking dog shit, okay?
The public's anger stems from the high cost of the Seine cleanup project, which is backed by £1.2 billion in state funds. Critics argue that the resources could be better spent elsewhere and that the protest aims to highlight the absurdity of the government's spending priorities. A message on the website said, quote, because after putting us in bleep,
it is up to
them to bathe in our bleep. Which is also apparently the slogan of the campaign.
Yes.
A post announcing the event, which is on Twitter, says, on Sunday, June 23rd, we expect many of you to come and take a bleep in the Seine. Paris Olympics, July 26th through August 11th. Paris will be the main host city, but events will take place in 16 other locations across metropolitan France. Additionally, a subsite will be located on the island of Tahiti in French Polynesia. This international multi-sport event marks the 33rd Olympiad. And it might be...
Let's all go poop in the river?
Apparently.
You're in big trouble, though, pal. I eat pieces of shit like you for breakfast.
That is a different kind
you
of
You eat pieces
mob.
Of shit for breakfast? No.
I love it.
That is,
we're so mad at the government. What are we going to do?
That's a different kind of...
We're going to poop in the river.
Collectively, together, at the same time.
I can't wait. You know people are going to do it. I can't wait to see the photos of people just squatting and dropping deuces in the river. Oh, God. That's great.
That's...
The friggin' sports!
Brought to you... Defecation.
Brought to you by poop. We'll get to Godsmack and Bad News Happy Music next.
Rock Mornings, only on 95.7 The Rock.
You're about to enter a beautiful, exciting, wonderful new world.
A cockroach living in your nostril.
Now that's just nasty.
Add in some, haven't pooped for 30 days.
Poop is raining from the ceilings. Poop.
And sprinkle in some hashtag Florida Man for flavor.
Florida Man.
Florida Man.
Florida Man.
Florida Man.
Florida Man.
Florida Man.
Florida Man quits his Burger King job, steals all of their chicken nuggets.
It's bad news.
Bad news.
With happy music.
Let's rock.
A hump day edition of bad news. Mm-hmm. What do we got?
Well, you've seen medications that warn you not to operate heavy machinery under the influence. But wouldn't it be weird if a product warned you not to operate a tractor under the influence of pancakes? Somebody posted a label from a bottle of syrup after it went viral for this warning on the back. It said, quote, do not freeze and keep away from tractor and sun. Now, people are legitimately confused about why it should be kept away from tractors. One person joked, how quickly we forget. Doesn't anyone remember the great tractor syrup tragedy of 1963? But it turns out there is an explanation. The product is from the United Arab Emirates, and there's Arabic on the label. It's also translated into English, and it was a bad translation.
Ooh.
It was supposed to say keep away from heat, not tractors. The difference, however, between those words is just one small dot in Arabic.
Would you like a schmoke and a pancake?
A what?
A schmoke and a pancake. You know, flapjack and a cigarette? Hmm? All right. Cigar and a waffle? No. Pipe and a crepe? No. Bong and a blintz?
Watch out for that syrup and that tractor.
Careful. A 52-year-old man who broke into Buckingham Palace told police he didn't know where he was and he was just looking for somewhere to pee. The man climbed over gates at the Royal London residence and managed to get into the courtyard. That set off security alarms and police took a few minutes to arrive at the scene. Asked what he was doing, the man told officers he didn't realize where he was and he was only looking for somewhere to urinate. Mm. But police seized his phone and discovered he had been searching online for Buckingham Palace. And according to what the Westminster Court, the man admitted to trespassing on a protected site. Just a month after the Buckingham Palace incident, the same man was caught urinating outside a school in London.
This guy's got a pee problem?
Yeah. He then assaulted four police officers, punching one of them.
Oh, he's also got an assaulting police officer thing.
2 days after that, he tried to steal a woman's handbag and dragged her to the ground. He is now being sentenced to essentially probation and is banned from going near Buckingham Palace and told to undergo rehabilitation.
He definitely had the pee.
Thank you for that.
All the pee.
Mm-hmm. A 39-year-old man in Pennsylvania named Jonathan Storms was arrested for drunk driving instructing. Police got a call about a reckless driver. They'd seen a white pickup truck off the street and then, while backing up to try to get back onto the road, running over a sidewalk and some traffic cones. The cops tracked the driver down and found out it was a 14-year-old boy behind the wheel. Jonathan was in the passenger seat, drunk. He said he was a family member and was teaching the kid how to drive. Turns out Jonathan was really lit. After getting out of the car, he started dancing in the middle of the street.
Oh, yeah.
He was charged with endangering the welfare of children, corruption of minors, and public drunkenness.
I'm not that intoxicated.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Dance like nobody's watching.
Right?
Exactly. I don't think that's a good idea.
That's what he was doing. Drive like nobody's sober.
Whoops.
Dance like nobody's watching.
Mm-hmm. In Idaho, a turkey hunter was attacked by a female moose. The man inadvertently startled the female moose, which had two twin calves with her.
Oh, man, yeah.
The moose began to charge, and although he had fired two warning shots at the ground in front of her, she was not deterred.
Yeah, moose like what, bro?
Right. As the moose knocked him to the ground, he was able to fire a third shot, which did hit the animal. The moose ran off, and the hunter was able to leave the area safely. The wildlife people say they'll be placing signs along the river in the vicinity of the encounter, cautioning people to be aware of the moose with calves and to maintain a safe distance.
Yeah, that's not the moose.
Well, I hope that moose is okay.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, one shot, maybe, you know, glanced off.
I mean, they're huge animals.
Oh, yeah.
Hmm. This guy has had quite a career as a criminal. He put the career in career criminal. A Kentucky man, famous for racking up more than 1,300 arrests over his lifetime, has now died at the age of 74. Henry Earl, who made national news as the world's most arrested man for his prolific rap sheet, died late last week. He apparently had no family that could be contacted to attend the ceremony. This vagabond was busted roughly 1,300 times, much of that alcohol-related offenses.
Mm.
He's been arrested more than 1,500 times, excuse me, over the past 5 decades. His first arrest came in 1970. He got busted for carrying a concealed weapon at the age of 20. Since then, he spent more than 6,000 days in jail. His incredible penchant for breaking the law landed him on Jimmy Kimmel Live in 2004. However, he was not able to attend in person because he was locked up at the time.
For your anniversary, we'll give you 1,000 days. Don't you think that's appropriate?
No, sir. It's a lot of time.
It's a lot of time, but you can do it.
No, sir, I can't.
Well, just do the best you can.
No, sir.
Well, we'll see you Thursday. See if you like it then, okay?
That's some solid advice from the judge. Well, do the best you can.
Right.
With your 1,000 days on your 1,000th arrest.
Right.
Yes.
Judge gave him a fitting punishment to fit the crime there. Yeah.
A police officer in San Diego has resigned.
Oh, yeah, he did.
After an embarrassing incident.
What happened?
Where he was forced to get help from a fellow officer after he got locked in the backseat of his own police cruiser with a woman who he had arrested for suspected car theft.
Yeah.
Officer Anthony Hare had been assisting in the arrest of people involved in suspected car thefts. One of them was a woman who had an outstanding warrant. Officer Hare's body camera captured a conversation between him and the woman during the transport. The dialogue took a concerning turn when the woman made suggestive remarks towards the officer.
She said, "I'm ready to F right now."
Yes. So as it turns out, the officer, supposedly while on the way to jail, pulled into a quiet neighborhood, and
so
they were there for a while.
And didn't realize that his car has GPS and all sorts of other tracking devices.
He deactivated his body camera.
Oh, that'll fill them.
About 20 minutes later, the officer had to contact a fellow cop asking about a master key for patrol cars. He admitted that he was locked in the back seat with a woman and needed help after over an hour in the back seat
together. I was just checking on her.
A supervisor arrived to unlock the door. The officer maintained he was merely checking on the woman and that the door accidentally locked behind him.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Despite the explanation, an investigation revealed traces of semen on his belt.
You give us your belt, sir?
The woman denied any inappropriate behavior during their time together.
It's like, what am I going to do? I'm locked up back here.
Right?
I got handcuffs on.
Not much he could do.
I'm not doing anything. I'm just back here minding my own business. This guy
he
comes back here to check on me.
And all the things. And then
all of a sudden there's semen.
Yeah. Here's the deal, man. I got a dark side. There's a demon in me.
It's true. He has semen in him.
I said demon.
But you also have semen in you, remember?
Not relevant, but thank you, Alan.
All that technology shoved into those cop cars,
right?
And you didn't think you thought you were going to get away with it?
Right?
Come on, bro. Come
and
on.
A couple of stories involving nudity this morning.
Oh.
A Virgin Australia flight from Perth to Melbourne had to turn around after taking off after a male passenger allegedly ran naked through the cabin, knocking a crew member to the floor. Police in Australia met the plane when it returned to the Perth airport and arrested the man.
So he got naked while on the plane?
Yes. Okay. Virgin spokesperson said the flight returned due to a disruptive passenger.
Mm-hmm, you could say that.
The police got calls from airport staff, and the officers arrested a man after he allegedly ran naked through the plane mid-flight, knocking a crew member to the floor. Some fellow passengers jumped up and intervened and were able to tackle the guy.
I'm
to
not
the ground.
Touching the naked guy on
he
the plane.
He was then handcuffed and walked to the back of the plane. He was taken off once they landed for assessment at a hospital.
Oh, naked guy on the airline. I wish I hadn't seen your family jewels near the cockpit when you ran down the outlast beam.
So did he get naked in his seat or did he go to the bathroom to get naked?
The story doesn't say.
Because it's difficult to get naked quickly in your
seat. Unless
he's
wearing a one-piece, like a romper or something.
You'd have to go to the bathroom. You couldn't do that
without
alerting.
Or he's got gym shorts and a t-shirt.
There's not
much room
in the bathroom either.
Gym shorts and a t-shirt. Whoop, whoop.
Yeah.
And then it's all done. And I'm not, you know me, Shaw, I'm all for beating people up on planes when they start acting a fool, but I'm not touching the naked guy.
I gotcha.
Nope.
Let somebody else deal with that.
Yep.
And one more naked story, this out of Albuquerque, New Mexico, where the internet has been full of posts of a naked man posing on top of the Bumblebee Transformer statue. This is in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Police got many calls reporting a man sitting on top of the statue, and they added that he was completely naked. When officers arrived...
Oh, he was naked, too. Yeah. I saw the pictures.
They found 40...
That doesn't look very comfortable up there,
no,
either.
No, he was not comfortable.
Very angular and pointy.
Yeah, not a good, easy place to sit. This guy's name is Hector Malero, and he was on top of the statue wearing a bunny suit around his ankles.
Yeah, it's one of those, like, 20-foot-tall statues, too. It's not like, you know, like the one in the Dells with the... You've been by the Tilted House next to the water park? They got
like
the
that? Trans...
Yeah, it's huge.
Back to the bunny suit, which was around his ankles. It's not clear if this guy was at a furry convention, if he'd been hired as a bunny performer, or just had a really bad bender that led him to climb the statue. Police were able to convince him to safely climb down with help of a ladder. He was charged with indecent exposure.
One of our main concerns was that he could have hurt himself. He could have fallen. And within a few minutes, they took him away, I think, probably to a holding station down the street. He returned again after he was released, fully clothed in a nice white outfit that they provided at the holding station.
Didn't get enough the first time, Shaw.
Apparently not.
Wanted to go for a second ride.
I am Optimus Prime.
No, you're a Bumblebee. And you got a naked butt guy right sitting right as his butt is right there.
If only they had a little fence to put around it, Shaw, right. Like the Ten Commandments.
Keep us all safe.
Keep them all safe.
You ever seen a grown man naked?
Yeah, he was on a plane running up and down the aisle, and then he went to Arizona and jumped on top of Bumblebee.
Oh, this is in the middle of the day, right on a huge intersection. Yeah. There's traffic everywhere. He's just... Was he waving? Hello, welcome to downtown. First of all, did you know there was a Bumblebee statue?
Did not.
Not in Arizona, but I knew there's one in the Dells. We drove by it when we were up there too long ago.
Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah, it's similar to that one.
Oh, then he's just left to walk away naked? Just make way with yourself?
Well, he got that nice white outfit. Didn't you hear him?
Just walking around. How do you clean that then?
Oh, you got to hose it off.
Okay. Yeah, you got to go up there with some sort of chemicals and get that cleaned off, right?
I'm telling you, you got to start washing more of your stuff because you never know where it's been. I tell you this all the time. You just kind of guffaw at me every time I tell you about fruits and vegetables. People are peeing on them.
I'm into limes now. I'm washing limes. I'm into
there's a guy
lime season, Shaw.
Did you see the guy in Italy? Did you see the guy in Italy that stuck the fuel hose up his rear end?
I did not. And Shaw, yeah. I'm washing all my limes.
Yes.
Are you doing that?
No, I'm going to now.
I didn't before, and now I'm a...
A lime washer.
I'm a lime washer, Shaw. It's lime season, and I'm not doing that.
Bad news, happy music. Thank you, Shaw. Yep. We'll talk to you tomorrow. Going to get to our daily check-ins after some Five Finger Death Punch.
Rock Mornings, Monday to Friday, 6 to 9. Call.
Hello.
Email.
I tried emailing you.
Text. So many ways to check in with us. Check. We rely on you guys for traffic updates, requests, and all sorts of other stuff.
Check this out.
RockMornings.com. Visit the website for all of our contact information. Listen to the show live on the website. Check out our daily podcast as well. Got a text earlier from Cody. Actually, a message on Facebook. When we were talking about a third of Americans think that this counts as exercise. And the this happened to be doing the dishes. And that's it. Just doing the dishes. Not... A whole day of chores where you're cleaning, vacuuming, laundry, all
vacuuming,
that.
Vacuuming, mopping, laundry, mowing the lawn. Those weren't in it. It was just standing at the sink and doing the dishes. I mean, you're doing the dishes. But...
Cody said masturbating is a good exercise, LMAO.
I was waiting for that to be an answer.
You knew it was coming.
I... Too easy.
That's what she said. Thank you, Cody. I guess if you're Sting, do that tantric stuff. Hours and hours and hours.
That's a whole other thing, though.
Got some incense.
Does he bring his heart rate to like 8 beats a minute or something?
I don't know what the hell he does. I don't know. I got enough trouble of my own. I don't need to worry about the hell Sting's doing with his wiener. Bill, the FedEx guy, must have tried to call in for Killing Me Shaws.
What'd he say?
Said it was all good and ringing, and I felt like I could have been a contender. And then it said the called party has declined my call, and I couldn't get through again. Again, this is day one. I'm trying to remain open-minded.
Bill,
we'll figure it out.
We think you're important. Thanks for trying to play.
We love you, Bill.
Of course we do.
The phones, however, don't have an affinity for Bill. Selective hearing, Stu. Same as Cody. Talking about third of Americans think that this counts as exercise. Selective hearing, Stu, though, said sex.
Yeah.
Not just solo. Eric wanted to hear some Linkin Park. We did that. You're welcome. Doc texted in earlier when we were talking about Stuart Haas Racing. Said three of the four Stuart Haas charters have already been spoken for. More info on Friday when we talk racing with Doc. Wally Wilbur said 8:54 a.m. You knew it was coming. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, I did know that.
I said it.
As soon as you said, people call this exercise. Well, and that technically is, isn't it? That's
what heart rate gets up, endorphins, all the things, right?
Very good for you.
That's what they say. Wouldn't know I'm married. Jay in Kentucky says, thanks, Shaw, for bringing Kentucky up again. People have almost forgotten the Louisville PGA. What? We had a story. Which one of these was in Kentucky?
I don't know. Was it was one of the
wasn't the syrup? Wasn't the Buckingham Palace?
Was it the cop? The cop in
Pennsylvania
the car?
It must have been. No, that was in San Diego. Was it the most arrested guy? Was he in Kentucky?
Oh, he must have been then.
Because the one naked guy was on a plane. The other naked guy was in Arizona, right?
On Bumblebee.
So it must have been the most arrested guy.
You can't help it. That's your own story to own.
Hey, he's got a life to live, and he lived it. Thank you for all the correspondence. Have a great rest of your day. We'll talk to you tomorrow.